one to thank for all she's done will be the first person who speaks, and that's the president of the Secular Humanists of the Low Country, Amy Monsky. Happens to be the coordinator of the Secular Coalition for South Carolina. She started the first Camp Quest in South Carolina and has done many more things. After Amy says a few words, we'll have Elisabeth Cornwell, who's executive director of the Richard Dawkins Foundation, followed by Sean Faircloth, who gave that rousing introduction last night, and is also Director of Policy and Strategy of the Richard Dawkins Foundation. And then we'll have some other guy say a few words without the word foundation. But first we'll have Amy Monsky.
Welcome to the brunch with Richard Dawkins. It's great to see so many people here. It's been an exciting weekend. We have filled every place we've been this weekend, starting with Yo Burrito when we reserved just the back section. And for those of you that were there, you saw that we not only took the back section, we took the entire restaurant. After we filled Yo Burrito, then we filled the auditorium and three overflow rooms, and people were just everywhere. And today we're filling this ballroom, so as you can see, we are definitely not alone. So, as Herb said, I'm the president of the Secular Humanists of the Low Country. We are the local community. We're no longer just a group, we're a community of atheists, humanists, free thinkers, agnostics, you name it. We've been around for almost 20 years now. So this is definitely not a new thing. This is not just a trend. This is the way it is. We do lots of things each month, lots of fun activities. Many of them are social. We do monthly speaker meetings. We are bringing Andy Thompson in this month. He'll be the speaker next Sunday. That's at 4 o'clock. If anybody that's not familiar with what we do, he'll be here at 4 o'clock at Gage Hall at 4 Archdale Street. He's going to talk about why we believe in gods. We also have a...
Not us.
You don't believe in a god? I think I might be in the wrong place. Okay. Also, we have a movie club. We have a book discussion group. We have happy hour. We started a trivia night each month. We do all kinds of fun things. We have a family group, a family support group, and we do a family activity each month. And we have stuff for parents throughout the month. In addition to the fun stuff we do, we definitely have a community service element to our group. Each month we have a volunteer activity where we go out into the community and show people that we are good without God, that we are good people, we live good lives, we are part of the community, and we give back. We have a charity of the quarter that we choose every 2 months. The one for this month is the Palmetto House, which is a homeless shelter for women and children in Somerville. And we are going to do, as part of the Somerville Cares Day of Service in May, on May 4th, we've adopted them and we'll be doing a community service project there where we're renovating their outside patio area. And this is important because not only are we helping them, we're participating in this day, the Somerville Cares Day of Service, where, you know, 20-some other organizations throughout the community are coming together as a community effort. So not only are we helping somebody, we're participating as part of the community. We are not just a group, we are part of the community, and we're showing people out in the community that we will no longer be marginalized, that we are part, and we're taking our seat with everybody else. Along the lines of showing everybody that we're not going to be marginalized anymore, I'm sure many of you are familiar with the Flower Town Festival. That for those those that don't, the Flower Time Festival is a community event that is sponsored by the Somerville YMCA. It's one of the largest art fairs in the Southeast. It's in the top 20 events. There are 200 to 250,000 people that come. And most of the booths that are set up are artist booths. But they also have booths available for nonprofit organizations to come and share information about their organization. And SHL, because we are part of the community, wanted to be a part of this as well. To let people know that we're here and to reach out to those of us who would like to know that, they're not alone. They thought that they were, but we want to let them know that we're here. And our application was rejected. Without giving us a reason for that rejection at that point, we had only to rely on what I was told over the phone. Back in December when I had called to ask if it would be okay for us to participate, and I was told no, that they're a Christian organization. So fortunately, the American Humanist Association's Humanist Legal Center, the Appiani Humanist Legal Center, took our case, and they contacted the Flower Town Festival and told them that what they were doing was not okay. And they didn't want to listen at first, but after we filed and said, filed a complaint with the state and said that we intended to file court, I believe what it said was after deliberation and prayer, and oh yeah, talking to their legal team, they decided to let us in. So we are now going to be a part of that. And I'm very excited. So that's April 5th through 7th. And we are going to need help staffing the tables. So, you know, please let us know after that. Not only do we need help staffing the tables for that, we need help from you to let us know what would you like to see. What would you like to see us do? What would you like to see us offer? So please, you know, make a point to be, to not just, to be a part of the group and to take ownership. Because this group is what we make it. And this group, it can't be a group of just one. It's got to be a group of all of us, and we all have to participate. So let us know what you think. Let us know what you like. The final thing that I'd like to tell you about SHL is that the last thing that we've got planned for this year that I'm very excited about is we're going to do something for the National Day of Reason this year. That's on May 2nd, the first Thursday in May. And perhaps you recognize the first Thursday as May is also the National Day of Prayer. So what we're going to do to celebrate, we sat around and we thought about it, and we thought something really fun to do. We're going to have a free thought slam, kind of like a poetry slam where we're going to go into a coffee house and have an open mic night, and everybody can come up and read their favorite free thought quote. So look for details on that, but that's in the works. So I guess I'd like to close by saying this group, for me personally, has been an amazing experience. And I love the entire Free Thought movement. And over the last 4 years, to see us grow, not just in this local community, but as a larger community, has been amazing. And looking at the future of the group, or the future of the movement, you know, it's definitely with our youth. And I want to end by just telling you about Camp Quest, if you don't know about it already, that it's a summer camp for kids from humanist, atheist, etc. families. And because our movement is growing so much, I think that the Camp Quest is such a vital part of that for our youth, to give them the community that we here as adults, I know there are a few children in the room, but mostly this is a community of adults, that we need to provide this for our children so that we can pass it on and continue to grow. So Camp Quest is a traditional summer camp with a focus on humanist values and critical thinking, and where we teach kids not what to think, but how to think. And that is for Camp Quest South Carolina. We have one in South Carolina. Our last summer was our first session. And this year will be July 21st through the 27th. So with that, I just want to thank you again for being here and being a part of this and letting me be a part of this as well. And I'd like to turn it over to the Executive Director of the Richard Dawkins Foundation, Elisabeth Cornwell.
Charleston is just a beautiful city. It's the first time I've been here, and it's just lovely. I do want to pay special thanks to Sharon and Herb Silverman who have been our hosts here, but also Herb has been niggling me for the past, oh, I don't know, 8 months, knowing that Richard was going to be coming here, saying, can he come to Charleston? When can Richard come to Charleston? And it's not always easy to say yes, because we don't, you know, this Richard's schedule is pretty tight, but I'm so glad it finally worked out. So thank you, Herb, for being persistent. I do want to acknowledge Richard Dawkins, because his generosity with his time is tremendous, and he doesn't have to be here. He doesn't have to come to the U.S. as many times as I asked him to come to the U.S., and so I think we should all just be really grateful that Richard is as generous as he is, and it's always a pleasure working with him and working for him. So thank you, Richard. I'm just going to tell you a few things about the Richard Dawkins Foundation here in the U.S. In fact, Richard was just in Miami. He was visiting a professor there, and we did a rather large talk in the, Richard did in the basketball court, and we had well over 4,000 people attending that talk. It was a great crowd. And that same day, we also launched our Spanish language website, which is a has the look and feel of our English language website. It's pretty much run by a group of people in Mexico City, so it does translate some of our articles into Spanish, but mostly what this group does is find articles that are pertinent to the Spanish language communities. Spain, South America, Central America, Mexico, as well as the United States and the Philippines. So it's been a tremendous effort by our web team in Colorado, and we do have some tremendous people working for the Richard Dawkins Foundation. We dedicate so much of our time and effort and funds to our website, and I hope all of you have visited that website. It's just a pleasure working with these people, and the reach that we're getting already is pretty tremendous, with over 1 million hits a month. But with the Spanish language website, we hope to extend our reach to areas that really, really do need to know that there's community out there. There's a very, very strong undercurrent of secularism in the Spanish-speaking communities. So please, if you get a chance, let people know. If you could tweet or put it on your Facebook or on your blog, we'd appreciate it. Letting us know. We will be doing this type of thing with some other groups as well. We want to do one in Arabic. We're going to be doing one in French. And I think our next one that's going to roll out is in German. Not that there's like a huge problem in Germany. but they are interested. There is a lot of, you know, science and things. And there is a creeping religion and throughout Europe. So we're looking for people who can actually sort of run the website. So it's not us, it's not people who are not within the community who are running the website. We want people in that community. We also hope to do one with African Americans, with gay and lesbians, with ex-Mormons, ex-Muslims, and so on. So we're growing that, and hopefully we will eventually reach every corner of the world. And your support has been letting other people know about this website really, really does help us. And the foundation is also involved, obviously, in bringing Richard around to different areas to speak. There will be a tour coming up in September and October for his new book, which is his autobiography. And, you know, that's a big part of what we do, and we get Sean Faircloth out speaking, and I know that Andy Thompson, who is also one of our trustees, is going to be here next week, and I do encourage you to go see his talk. It's an excellent talk, his book is excellent, and Andy is a terrific person, and again, great to work with him. I'm sorry, he wanted to be here this weekend, but was unable because of work constraints. But the other things that the Richard Dawkins Foundation has been doing things like providing childcare at conferences so that people could bring their families. One of the things that, that has been a concern is how do we bring more women into the movement? And of course, one of those things, women tend to be the provider for childcare, so we try to offer childcare, and that seems to have gotten a good response. And for more things that we're doing, we have done things with non-believers giving aid in terms of raising money to help in disasters. We raised over $500,000 for Haiti, and have raised money since then for other to help in others. But mostly it's trying to reach out and let people know that there is a community, that there are lots of people. And I think we really saw that last night, the fact that we had to turn people away. And I do want to mention that for anyone here who didn't get to see that, within the next 2 weeks we should have the videos up. And we also have, was anybody there for the taping with Richard and John Felston? Okay, so Mike, that's what I remember. So, people were showing up so early. Richard interviewed John Huddleston, who is a professor of biblical studies at the College of Charleston. And we went to the auditorium earlier, and much to our surprise, there was already people showing up, and this was at 3:30. So we took advantage of it, and we had some people sit down in the front of the audience and conducted the interview on stage. And that will also be on our website very, very soon. And again, one of the things that we do and we pay for are to have these events filmed, put on our website for free so that people can download them, they can share them with their friends, they can send them off to others. We're about communicating. We're about trying to get as many people to understand how we feel as secularists, as atheists, not as much to convert people, but at least give them the opportunity to read about why we are atheists and secularists, and why, as a community, we need to form together. And that leads me to introducing our next speaker, which is Sean Faircloth, who is our Director of Strategy and Policy at the Richard Dawkins Foundation. So he's on our political arm of things and understands lobbying and understands politics. And of course, as you got to hear him last night, he's an incredible speaker and able to get people excited about what we do and building grassroots organizations. We can't do this alone. Richard Dawkins cannot make changes happen on his own. Nor can Herb, nor can Amy, nor can any single individual make things happen. It takes us organizing. And as I've said again and again, if the Christian right can do it, we can do it. We have to be smart about organizing. We have to be smart about running for things like school boards. We have to be smart about writing letters to the editor. We need to let people know that we are out there, as Amy said, and not just talking amongst ourselves. We need to stand up and really take back the traditional values, the real traditional values that this country was based on. So without further ado, may I welcome Sean Faircloth.
I know you've got a good size room when you can't get to the podium. And as usual, Dr. Cornwell, our executive director, was modest. You folks can hear me in the back okay? Okay. That she is really her brainchild. I mentioned last night about the A campaign. The website and all of its improvements are really her leadership that really got us there, the new Spanish language website. So we've made huge progress, and really it is largely to her credit, so let's give her a round of applause. I'm also very upset because Elisabeth and I were in the DC area and we've gone to trivia games together, but I'm upset that Amy actually has an organized trivia group. I'm deeply jealous of this area. I was speaking to a group in back and a woman back who was talking about morality and atheism and humanism, and the first thing that popped up in that discussion of morality was sex. And then I was talking to a group at the front, I was talking to a woman, Vera, who's African American, and she was talking about how there was a lot of good reasons why folks remain in African-American churches that are very logical and reasonable. And I want to kind of connect those two things, if I can. First, with the thought from the back of the room, isn't it interesting that a lot of times when we hear morality these days, the first thing it translates to is sex? Well, I just want to make a little suggestion, a little old-fashioned morality. Consenting adults. How about that? Here's another one. Number two, I was a politician in Maine for 10 years. Here's a little bit of old-fashioned small-town morality. Mind your own business. How about that for some morality about sex? Because when I was a kid, my parents, they weren't politicians themselves, but they were involved in the political process. And at that time, they really admired, as they should have, giants who walked this earth. And two giants who walked this earth, one was 5'6", and his name was Martin Luther King. And another giant was 5'9", and his name was Robert Kennedy. And no two people ever had more death threats that they knew about, that they were told about, from the FBI. They knew every day when they got up in front of huge crowds the risk that they were taking. Now, these were two religious men, but I want to tell you, when the ruling came down from the Supreme Court in 1962 that there won't be government-imposed, government-orchestrated prayers in public schools, what did Dr. Martin Luther King say? He said he agreed with the decision. In fact, Dr. King said he felt even more confirmed that he agreed with the decision when he found out that the racist governor of Alabama, George Wallace, was so much against the decision. He said, well, then I know I'm right. So that's where the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King was coming from, and Robert Kennedy was coming from. And we have to recognize that there were very good things that came from the social movement in the black churches in this country, particularly in that era, and that there is common cause to be had with people who care about those values. And when Dr. King and Bobby Kennedy were walking on this earth and using that word morality, they were not talking about your naughty bits. They were talking about your children. They were talking about the future. And that's really what this is about. And I said to a few people at different tables that we're going to have a lot of fun, all of us in this room, in Iowa. Because that's the vacation spot of America. Let me tell you why we're all going to Iowa in 2015 and the beginning of 2016. You know, Jimmy Carter, back in the early 1970s, said he was going to become President of the United States. Zero people believed him. Nobody knew who he was. And he came up with a troop of people from Georgia, not from Iowa, who bust up to the state of Iowa and changed the history of how politics works in this country. I went to the Iowa caucus campaigns this most recent cycle, and it was amazing. I mean, I'm a little small town politician. When I saw the Romney event, I saw a huge crowd of people. You know who the huge crowd of people were at his event? Reporters from Japan, Madrid, New York, Los Angeles. There were hardly any actual supporters and people. I have a friend there in Iowa that I got to meet who went around the last cycle and talked about healthcare. And he was just him, by himself, with a t-shirt, talking about healthcare. And he kept showing up and showing up and showing up. And these reporters, think of the poor reporters. They're sitting there for the entire year leading up to the caucus. They're desperate for stories. And they wrote a story about one guy with a t-shirt talking about healthcare. How many here saw video of or went to the Reason Rally? Okay, that was a huge event. If we got half of those people, if we got the people in South Carolina coming for 1 week, and people from New York coming from another 2 weeks, and we parse it out over the course of 2015, leading up to the January 2016 caucus, with t-shirts that say, get religion out of government, to find common cause, with those like in the African-American churches and the liberal churches that say they're going to remove religion from government, then we have a social movement that can gain media attention like nothing else and really transform society. We need to do this together, and we need to do it, as Amy mentioned, because of the next generation. I want to mention, I think there's a young man here named Carter Dawkins Owens. Where is Carter?
A little boy. So he's
dabbing
out.
Oh, he's dabbing out.
My mom's here.
But Carter Dawkins Owens is named after Professor Dawkins. And I am convinced, based on evidence, what is happening for us is historically transformational. When Dr. Cornwell mentioned about this crowd in the University of Miami. You have to see it to believe it. You have to see the people coming up and saying, you changed my life. But now we need to take that, because Richard Dawkins has been generous with his time. He could command huge speaking fees. Most people at his level do that. Oftentimes, he doesn't. He shows up because he cares about this. We owe it to him. We owe it to this cause to make it count. And by making it count, I mean to say, yeah, it's 2013 now. I will show up and volunteer in Iowa in 2015, as will people from Washington State, Maine, Arizona, every single state of the union, to change this country, and we can do something transformational. Directly connected with that is leaders like Amy and others, like Herb Silverman, who have worked so long in this effort. Let's have regular statewide free thought conventions in every single state of the union by the year 2020. This is really important, because we need to build that farm team. We should not just rely upon a Richard Dawkins showing up to spark a big crowd. I mean, yesterday is an example. I believe that, you know, Richard just got to know John Huddleston at this walk we were doing yesterday. We set up, and Elisabeth set up this interview with him, and that will go on YouTube. And this is someone that, if we have statewide conventions, is part of that team of people who are experts in an area, whether it's the scriptures, or whether it's church-state separation, or whether it's lawsuits on issues, so that we don't need to rely on some international star to make things happen. So these regular conventions build this community. The ACLU has chapters in every single state, the Maine Civil Liberties Union and the Arizona Civil Liberties Union. We're going to have that, free thought conventions in every single state of the union, and we are going to expose the injustices that have spread throughout this country because of religious bias. I think sometimes secular people shy away from that word morality. I think it's a really important word, and that word has been stolen from us. It has been stolen. Real morality is about justice, and it's about civil rights. And in my book, I write about 10 areas of law. The two you know about, discrimination against gay people and removing women's reproductive rights, are two of the 10. But I also write about terrible oppression of children that many people are not even aware of. And I'm not talking about social oppression, which is awful enough. I'm talking about laws with religious bias that hurt children in the United States of America, plus 7 more areas of law. We are going to expose that. Thanks to Dr. Cornwell and Richard Dawkins, we had a meeting with a young lawyer in Portland, Oregon. And she is creating sort of a crowdsourced database where we're going to expose the ministers for a documentary who live off something called the parsonage exemption, which many of you may never have heard of in the IRS code, but they live high on the hog on your dime. And whether you use Google Maps or whatever, I want you to email me at organize@richarddawkins.net, because I tell you, that's going to look really good on YouTube when we see the houses of these rich ministers contrasted with the children who are harmed by religious bias in American law. And that kind of effort, that exposure in popular culture through a documentary, our organizing to go to Iowa, our organizing free thought conventions, we can be the ones. We can be the ones who become the next great cause of social change in this country. I admired my parents because they got to be there and help with Bobby Kennedy's campaign and support the values of Dr. King. That's what we need to do. We need to be the grassroots leaders for this next generation. You have the leaders here with Herb and Amy, but most importantly, you. You are the leaders. So let's take advantage. Let's take advantage and make it count that we are lucky to have the incredible catalyst and the incredible voice and leader that is our next speaker, Professor Richard Dawkins.
I haven't come with a prepared speech, and I shall be brief. I was, of course, immensely encouraged by the huge crowd that turned out last night. I was immensely encouraged by the more than 4,000 crowd that turned out in Miami a couple of nights ago. Clearly, we are on the march, and you've heard from Elisabeth and Sean the kinds of things that are going on, and Amy and Herb. So I am very, very encouraged by that. I'm I think it's as well, though, to mention some things that are rather discouraging. Many, many times before, and also on this particular trip to America, I meet young people, such as people here, who say that they are atheists, but that they are disowned by their parents, or estranged from their parents, or their parents have thrown them out, or their parents are not inviting them to meals and things like that, because of what I could only call bigoted prejudice. I wonder whether we could have a show of hands of people who are in any way estranged from their parents or have difficulties with their parents because of their stand. And that looks like about half the room. And that, I think, is a shocking indictment of something, and I'm not quite sure what. I don't want to make the suggestion that these problems are purely American. In Britain we have somewhat different problems, and one of our problems is, I'm sorry to say, Islam, which I think is less of a problem here. Only this morning I had an email from Lawrence Krauss, who many of you may know, a great hero of the freethinking and intellectual and scientific movement. Lawrence spoke at a debate against a Muslim spokesman in University College London last night. And I don't know whether you know, but University College London is a beacon of free thinking. It was the first university in England to be founded on purely secular lines, and the first university in England to admit women and men on equal terms. At University College London last night, when Lawrence turned up for this debate, he suspected in advance, because I warned him in advance, that the Muslim organizers were proposing to have the audience segregated by sex, with the women sitting at the back, shades of Rosa Parks. I warned Lawrence about this and encouraged him to cancel the event. He contacted the organizers and was told that it was fine, they were not going to have segregated audience. He turned up at the University College London and found that indeed they were segregated. The women were sitting at the back, there was a separate section for men, and a separate section for couples. Were they asked for their marriage certificate? Lawrence immediately protested and was given permission to announce to the audience that anybody could sit wherever they like. Three young men, whom Lawrence described as nice, gentle kids, got up and moved from the men's section to the women's section. They were then descended upon by security guards who threw them out on grounds that they were a threat. Threat to whom? Lawrence then packed his bag and said he was leaving, and Lawrence walked out. Good for Lawrence. Unfortunately, the organizers chased after him and persuaded him to come back and said that they would allow the three young men to go back to their seats in the women's section. Lawrence, being a decent, polite man, agreed to go back. I'm actually sorry he did. I think he would have done better to have walked out and given this disgraceful event the publicity it deserves. I'm sorry to take your time. This is not an American issue, but it only just happened. And it'll be up on our website, richarddawkins.net, probably by now, but I'm not sure. I've just sent it on. Another anecdote, really, that I think is disturbing. When I was in Miami 2 or 3 days ago, I was told of a teacher in a Miami school who had taught evolution and was... there was a complaint by one child who complained to her parents, and the children complained to the school. The school disciplined the teacher and forced the teacher to stop teaching evolution. As I think I told you last night, the teacher was enterprising enough to import another teacher who was a professor at the University of Miami to teach evolution. This was a flagrant example of capitulating, caving in to religious interests because we have all, and it's the same with the case at University College London, we've all been brainwashed, however, whatever our own opinions, we've been brainwashed into treating religion with kid gloves, as though somehow it deserves special consideration. If you think about that incident in London last night, and imagine that instead of being segregated by sex, there had been a section for white people, a section for black people, and as in apartheid South Africa, a section for coloured people, as they called them. It would have been, London would have been on fire with indignation. But all we nice, decent, liberal people are so terrified of being thought anti-Islamic, Islamophobic, anti-religious, that we cave in, we capitulate. School head teachers capitulate to parents who complain about the religious interests of their little darlings being trampled on. To hell with religious interests. We have to... stand up for much more fundamental interests of decency and enlightenment. And that's what the people in this room are about. And I've been very inspired to meet people here, to see the many, many people who turned up last night and who turned up in Miami, the many people who turned up on our earlier trip a couple of weeks ago to Colorado, where we were. Richard Dawkins Foundation was fighting against the Good News Club. How many people know about the Good News Club? The Good News Club, it seems, is running a special drive in Colorado at the moment. You know, their aim is to subvert children's education by going in immediately after the school bell has sounded, not into private premises where they could do so, but into school premises where they are able to fool to dupe the children into thinking that these are legitimate teachers. And so the children go home puzzled and confused because a teacher has told them that they're going to hell if they don't accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Something like that. Of course, it's not a teacher. It's a member of the Good News Club. And owing to some kind of remarkable decision by the Supreme Court, they're able to do this. So we were in there trying to alert the parents and the citizens of Colorado to this menace. And we brought in Catherine Stewart, whose book, The Good News Club, I strongly recommend to you. And she made speeches in both Colorado Springs and Denver. Well, as I said, I think we're on the march, and I think we shouldn't underestimate the difficulties that lie before us and the show of hands that we had of people here who've been estranged from their parents as a result of their simply thinking for themselves is an indication of the problems that we have. So we are moving, we're going in the right direction, but we have problems, and don't let's underestimate them. So thank you all for your staunchness in this fight. And of course I'd like to add my thanks to Herb and Sharon and all the others who've shown us such wonderful hospitality here. Thank you very much indeed.
I really appreciate the generosity that he's shown in terms of time and involvement in this movement. And as he said, Richard Dawkins is not going to be around forever. He is the closest we have to infallibility in our movement, but even Richard is not infallible, and he's Professor Emeritus, just like we have a Pope Emeritus, except nobody thinks Richard is infallible or will be able to carry on forever. So as people in the Dawkins Foundation have said, it's up to people here to carry on the good work that Richard Dawkins and others have started. And hopefully in 20 years or so, people will be honoring some of you at national conventions for the work that Richard Dawkins and his group have helped inspire you to do in the future. So thank you all.